Hello, Cort LIndahl here. Today I'd like to continue the theme from my last talk about the Vatican, the Temple Mount, and what Constantine may have had to do with it. And really, what I found, if you look at this progression of Byzantine rulers, there were a few times that Emperor Arcadius, and that's an important name to note going forward as it relates to what I call the Arcadian mysteries, all had intermarried, or at least a few of them, with Merovingian women prior to the time that the Merovingian kings became Christian. So they were still pagan in nature during these periods where they interfaced with Byzantine kings, at least at first. Now later, apparently, a descendant of Emperor Arcadius, a female named Arcadia, married Emperor Zeno, who by coincidence was holding hostage Theodoric the Great in his court at that time, the Ostrogothic ruler, who was being held hostage in a deal that Emperor Zeno had made with his father. And it's also interesting that the name Zeno kind of pops up in our studies later as well in the Zeno narrative, which I believe is bogus. But that name is interesting, and it's associated with Venetian families that may have descended from Byzantines. So we're seeing this connection from Constantinople and subsequent Byzantine rulers after Constantine the Great developing Ravenna, Italy, as the center of the Christian faith, as opposed to Rome, as it would happen later when the Latin Church became more dominant and there became more of a rift between the Greek Orthodox Church and the Catholic Church, or Latin Church of Rome as we know it today. But Ravenna is very interesting because if you examine the architecture there, there are three interesting octagonal structures. And then you also have the mausoleum of Theodosius, not Theodoric, I called him earlier. Emperor. So Ravenna is a very interesting place. You have the mausoleum of Theodoric the Great, which has one of the largest cut stones ever produced as the lid or roof of his mausoleum. You have the Basilica San Vitale, built in kind of a joint effort by Theodoric and Justinian I, which has some amazing mosaics in it that are world-renowned, that are very kind of revealing in this vein of what I was speaking about in the last video with regard to Coptic or Gnostic beliefs that Byzantine rulers may have held kind of exclusive to them. But beyond Basilica San Vitale, we have the Arian Baptistry and the Baptistry of Neon. And really what I'd like to address first is the alignment of the Church of Sant Apollinare Nuovo, which was built during the same era as what we call the Al-Aqsa Mosque on the Temple Mount, which many people believe is a Muslim structure, but it's clear that it was once called the Church of St. Mary Justinian, and the original form of the church that was there resembles the Basilica of Sant Apollinare Nuovo in Ravenna, Italy, very closely. So it's interesting that the Baptistry of Neon and Sant Apollinare Nuovo, both of whose construction predate the construction of the Dome of the Rock, another octagonal structure similar to the Baptistry of Neon, this alignment or New Jerusalem in Ravenna actually predates the original Jerusalem alignment that all of this architectural tradition refers to, using the Tower of the Winds and subsequent interpretations of it, leading us to Shugborough Hall, the Newport Tower, the Powder Magazine in Colonial Williamsburg that were kind of created in this tradition, but a long time later. So that was the later people's impression. But it's very interesting that the alignment of Sant Apollinare Nuovo and the Neon Baptistry predates the construction of the Dome of the Rock. And this supports my notion that Constantine had built an octagonal structure there earlier. And there's a lot more to back that up than the other part of my theory that says Constantine may have been entombed beneath the octagonal structure he built where the Dome of the Rock now stands. So this alignment of St. Apollinaire and the Neon Baptistry predating the construction of the Dome of the Rock suggests that they were creating a, quote, New Jerusalem in Ravenna before the Dome of the Rock was built, that is actually referencing the octagon that Constantine had built there before, that is rumored to have been there. Now, some sources even state that Constantine built this octagonal structure and that spolia or parts of it were used to actually rebuild the Dome of the Rock during the time of Emperor Justinian II in the 8th century. And that makes sense too and would fit the whole story as I'm seeing it as well. So it's interesting that there are those who speculate besides me that there was an octagonal structure on the Temple Mount where the Jewish temple originally had stood, that was valued by the Knights Templar in their occupation of the Al-Aqsa Mosque, as stated in the common history. And this may have led them to find the remains of Constantine, or proof that he indeed had different views of the Christian faith that would extend into the realm of Coptic belief and Gnostic belief in the canons of Christianity that weren't included in the Council of Nicaea, the canon of the Old and New Testaments as well. So this is very interesting. And really, to back that up, we can see later, let's go back to the mosaics at Basilica San Vitale, which is also an octagonal structure in Ravenna, Italy, that seems to have been built in this Greek tradition that goes back to a value of the Tower of the Winds, with each side of the octagonal structure being festooned with the bas-relief of a god dedicated to that direction of the wind. So we see this later being appreciated via the Greek culture of Justinian I and Byzantine rulers that came before him, like Emperor Arcadius, Emperor Honorius, Arcadius's brother, Theodosius, Constantius II, and so on, that all kind of seem to practice this tradition of talismanic architecture, including the installation of the obelisk of Theodosius in Constantinople and the Heliopolitan obelisk being installed in what would become the Vatican later. So it's interesting that they're using these stone monuments to kind of represent their faith, but I believe hidden in there is also a real practical use of the legal description of property, where they could compare these places to each other spatially and use that information in spiritual means back during that era, but also in practical means to show them the relationships between these places. So Ravenna, Italy is a very important place in the entire scheme of what we see going on. I won't go into too much detail about where the octagons there point, but going back to this alignment of Santa Apollinare Nuovo and the Neon Baptistry, there is a prominent literary figure giving us a clue that there is something important about this alignment that is not being told, because none other than the tomb of Dante Alighieri is located on this alignment in Ravenna, Italy, where he was exiled after his troubles in Florence, and subsequently writing the Inferno, which is, you know, a literary tomb that is said to inspire everybody from Sir Francis Bacon to Henry Wadsworth Longfellow and even Edgar Allan Poe. And it's really interesting that the root meanings of Dante Alighieri's last name, the name Edgar, all really have a similar meaning to that of Spear Shaker or Shakespeare as well. So there could be even a hidden tradition of the noble spear being propagated in these men's names. So even it is speculated by many that Dante may have been a Knights Templar. He lived during the right era, right before their persecution and right after, and was later persecuted himself, and had written this, the Inferno, which is a work of allegory and metaphor that really pokes fun at or exposes the powers that be of the day, including the Roman rulers, all the ecclesiastical figures, and we all know that how Dante assigns them to different levels of hell or different circles of hell and such. But it's obvious that Dante really inspired a whole future trend in literature, and he is also credited with kind of homogenizing the Italian language, which is split into a lot of different dialects, much in the same way that Shakespeare or Sir Francis Bacon is credited with homogenizing the English language. And this all speaks to kind of the nationalist ideals of literature and art through time, where it all had real meaning, either to promote religion, nationalist ideas, political ideas, and things like that. It was kind of like the media of the day, similar in ways people speculate that movies and music contain secret messages today. So during this day, we had ecclesiastical art and the flowering or beginning of literature in this form, where people are using it in a symbolic manner that is hidden. So none of this is directly said to you. And this is where your critics can really start to lay into you, because it's subjective about what you interpret from it. But when we start to see the Oak Island story seemingly given to us in Philip Sidney's Arcadia from 1580, over 200 years prior to a similar story being told to the public in relation to the money pit, we may begin to see how literature and themes in literature become symbols of nationalism and even cultural ownership of regions. We see part of this being the reason that people were speculating there were Vikings in New England long before L'Anse aux Meadows in Newfoundland was even discovered, trying to sort of falsely promote this idea, because many of the proofs that they came up with to say this was true were later thoroughly debunked, and the whole thing was exposed as being a romantic nationalist movement associated with Norway, in which poet Longfellow and his friends Old Bull and Christian Raffin, who wrote up the Newport Tower for the first time, speculating that it was Norse, leading us to many of the more modern theories, even extending to the Kensington Runestone. And I just want to make clear now, I think all of those are a later manifestation of the exiled Stuart kings that goes in a tradition back to Mary, Queen of Scots, and includes all the other Stuart kings that had these kind of conflicts with the parliamentarian form of government. And also, strangely, that these exiled kings or beheaded kings like Charles I, even quoted Pamela's prayer from Philip Sidney's Arcadia, the same book that includes the original Oak Island story, I feel, just prior to his beheading. But Pamela's prayer even addresses the freedom of religion. So it's kind of ironic that when we extend this to American history, that Catholic and Jewish people that had done a lot to create America, even though there were smaller numbers of them at the time, both were in favor of this concept of freedom of religion, which is an American value and always has been. And it's interesting to note, in England at that time, Catholics were persecuted for political reasons, you know, some of which were legitimate or not. I'm not commenting on. There's lots of reasons that people in England didn't like the Catholic faith and saw them as meddling in their government and culture and way of life too much. So later, Charles I, even though he was beheaded, kind of turns the tables on them and pleads for freedom of religion and uses this concept to show how he was persecuted. I feel all of this stems back to Ravenna, Italy, with their beginning and meager associations with what would be considered the Merovingian dynasty later. This later leads to the Plantagenet dynasty, and in more modern history, this whole notion that the bloodline of Jesus is related to French nobles and nobles of other country and even some, quote, common people. But really what I'm starting to see is this entire notion comes from their relation to Byzantine rulers and not Jesus Christ or Mary Magdalene herself. So those ideas may have been promoted by them, unless there is a connection between Constantine and his earlier ancestors and Jesus Christ and Mary Magdalene. And this is not uncommon, as is pointed out in the work of Ralph Ellis and another researcher, Joseph Atwill, that it's not uncommon for Roman or Byzantine interests to entirely fake history, just like we accuse our leaders of doing sometimes today. So there's lots of factors that need to be taken into account. I think often we look at the past and we assume that they did not have intelligence services or practice skullduggerous or manipulative means to gain what they wanted. So a lot of this is exposing that. And what we're going to do next time is we're going to extend this on, and I'm going to show you how Ravenna, Italy even connects to the famous Rennes-le-Château mystery there in the region of Septimania that was once the property of Theodoric the Great and was willed to his daughter and her Merovingian husband. And this is going to lead us into some of the rumors that the temple treasure, after it was sacked from the Temple of Peace of Rome, being brought to Septimania and hidden somewhere in the area. And this is what the original mystery of Rennes-le-Château refers to, with the layer of Father Saunier and other factors kind of being attached to the original mystery later in a way that has to do with the Cathars and alternate forms of Christian faith again, which keeps popping up through the whole story. Christianity really tells this story. So in the future, we'll also be looking at other subjects like how Chico, California connects to all of this, including direct family relations to the Alexander family that I've pointed out was involved in the mysteries of Nova Scotia and quite possibly Oak Island, and were the namesake of Alexandria, Virginia. So this kind of whole idea and whole movement of nationalism and using folklore to communicate these ideas and literature, we'll see transferred to Gold Rush era California in some very interesting ways that I've pointed out in the past in my work about the mysteries and legends of Mount Shasta. So thanks for listening to me again. It's good to sit here and talk and express this myself. It helps me organize my thoughts and makes me even study my own work anymore. So thanks a lot for being here again, and I appreciate it. Cort signing off. Talk to you next time. Cort LIndahl, thanks for joining me here at our look at the architecture of Ravenna, built by Theodoric the Great in the 6th century, about 165 years before the Dome of the Rock on the Temple Mount. We're going to see some amazing correlations. But first of all, let's look at the Arian Baptistry, built by Theodoric. It's an octagonal structure, and we look at the pointing qualities of these structures. And previously I had noted the star in the landscape of Rennes-le-Château pointing to Ravenna, and now I find the Arian Baptistry actually mimics this line that matches the famous star in the landscape of Rennes-le-Château pointing to the Rennes-le-Château chapel. Now this is not an odd association. Theodoric once ruled Septimania, the region where Rennes-le-Château is located. And indeed, his daughter even married the son of the Visigothic ruler Alaric.
Upon Theodoric's death, he did give control of Septimania to his Merovingian relatives. And we see a lot of associations between Theodoric and the Byzantine royal court of Emperor Zeno, where he was raised as the hostage when he was a child. So he was exposed to the ways of the Byzantine rulers at this time. Now this next association is amazing because what Theodoric has done here has mimicked the layout of the Al-Aqsa Mosque and Dome of the Rock on the Temple Mount. The Al-Aqsa Mosque is reminiscent of the construction qualities of San Apollinare Nuevo, shown here to the right, that whose orientation can be used to create an arc on the globe that points to the Neon Baptistry, another octagonal structure built by Theodoric the Great as the baptistry for the Greek Orthodox faith. Theodoric created an era of religious tolerance and built structures for many different Christian faiths in Ravenna. And here we think he was emulating the Temple Mount layout, even though the Dome of the Rock supposedly didn't exist. This is an interesting possible message from Theodoric telling us that Constantine indeed did build an octagon there and was buried there. And we see this being repeated by famous poet Dante, who is actually interred on this alignment. His tomb is located on this kind of reproduction of the Temple Mount in Jerusalem in Ravenna, Italy. And we see this starting an early historical trend of New Jerusalems being built around the world that include an octagon aligned with the church many times. And here on the Temple Mount we see that repeated, and this is all kind of a tradition that descended from the Tower of the Winds in Athens and was adapted by Constantine, who built at least four octagons. And some sources state that he did indeed build an octagon on the Temple Mount that may have been demolished. And it is even possible that the Dome of the Rock is this structure that's been modified by the Muslims for their purposes. And we know the Al-Aqsa Mosque was built by Justinian I. And if you examine the interior of San Apollinare Nuevo and what is today the Al-Aqsa Mosque, you will see very similar attributes that indicate it came from a similar cultural source. Now, going back to Ravenna, you see the alignment there from a longer view. And we'll also examine some of the other structures here in Ravenna, including the Mausoleum of Galla Placidia, who also has an association with the temple treasure in this entire story, as she was supposed to have ended up with some of the items that were part of the temple treasure after Rome was sacked by Alaric. So it's interesting that the Mausoleum of Galla Placidia also points to the Baptistry of Neon in Ravenna. Now here we have the Basilica of San Vitale, the classic octagonal baptistry structure associated with the cathedral that seems to act as a geodetic marker on the face of the globe in the tradition of the Tower of the Winds. Here we'll examine some interesting directions that San Vitale points. Here we see it pointing to the location of the famous Kensington runestone. At first glance, this might seem a chance arrangement or a chance intersection with another mysterious object on the globe. But as we may see, later people may have interpreted these lines as meaning something and deposited things in association, or were searching for items that had been left earlier in association. So it's really interesting that Basilica San Vitale points to the Kensington rune. It points to the Kensington runestone, but it also points to Kensington Palace in London. This is interesting in that Admiral Anton's other estate, Moor Park, had a Tower of the Winds that also points to Kensington Palace to the southeast and the Kensington Runestone to the northwest, kind of mimicking this arrangement. Now back to Ravenna, we see Basilica San Vitale pointing to the southwest to another really interesting place that we've discussed before that has all of the lore and mythology of the Ark of the Covenant and the story of the Queen of Sheba's son bringing the Ark of the Covenant to Ethiopia. Here we see the southeasterly opposite direction from the Kensington Runestone transecting Egypt and Africa to Aksum, Ethiopia, the site of that the Ethiopian Orthodox Church states is the home to the real Ark of the Covenant. And we have seen a lot of value of the Christian lore of Ethiopia and a lot of these alignments of the array at the Vatican composed of the obelisk and windrose markers points to Lalibela, Ethiopia, where the Ark once rested as well. So that's an interesting association and value from both versions we see of the Christian churches here in Ravenna, the earlier version, and later at the Vatican with the classic Latin Church of Rome. Finally, we have another amazing association with the Temple of Peace of Vespasian in Rome that once housed the temple treasure that had been brought to Rome by Titus after he sacked the Temple Mount in 70 AD. Here we see the linear orientation of the Temple of Peace, the Forum of Augustus, and the Forum of Trajan aligning to create an arc on the globe. And we also know that Theodoric refurbished what was left of the Temple of Peace of Rome and the Temple Library of Peace when he ruled Rome himself. But here we see the alignment of these classic Roman fora pointing the way to the International Peace Garden on the border of the United States and Canada. We have the Peace Temple pointing to the Peace Garden with its array of chapel and octagon that exists as a new Jerusalem, just like the other places that we're discussing here today. So thank you for joining me here in this brief examination of Ravenna, Italy, and the architecture of Theodoric the Great. It appears that there may be some connection to Ravenna. I've spoken of this before, how the star there points to Ravenna, and how the cult of Mary Magdalene is kind of laid bare in an examination of the mosaics of Theodora at Basilica San Vitale with her niece and sister wearing Coptic tunic patches leads us to the history of Theodora, the weaving nuns in the monastery she created, and the possible later associations with Mary, Queen of Scots. I also see my latest work on Edgar Allan Poe. It appears Mr. Poe had a genealogy that may link him to many mysteries such as Oak Island, the Newport Tower, the Kensington Rune, and the Westford Knight. So that's an interesting development. And also see my book, The Shepherds of Arcadia Solution, that exposes how a literary circle of Elizabethan England may be responsible for the concept of Arcadia as we see it in the mysteries today. Also, The Geographic Mysteries of Sir Francis Bacon is there with a lot of insight into how those mysteries may have been applied in the colonies and the young United States and Canada. So thanks for joining me. We'll catch you here next time.